Be the chocolate tax on my raps. She innovates after sweet and cat naps. He at the funk club with the vibrate. Then they be crazy down with the five feet. It can't kick a plan than a crowd burst. Me, I be digging it.
Okay, so last time we were talking about a statistics problem appropriate both for classical dice and quantum dice. And this was a situation where you're promised that the die, which has, you know, D faces, is either very rigged, so one of the faces comes up with a very high probability, or the die is very balanced, so all the faces come up with a reasonably low probability. And in both cases, we came up with a reasonable measurement for trying to tell the difference. So in the classical case, we'd roll the die two times, or for allowed two copies of the die, and check the sorted histogram, and this would either look like this, meaning the two faces that came up were the same, or it would look like this, meaning the two faces that came up were different. And we analyzed the probability of these two outcomes. So the probability of getting two faces the same is this quantity delta, which is the sum of the squares of the pjs, where the p1 through pd are the die outcome faces. On the other hand, in the quantum case, we needed to design a measurement that was like an orthogonal decomposition of a two-fold tensor product of a vector space. And we did that into the symmetric subspace and the alternating subspace. And we calculated the probability that, you know, you would measure the two quantum dices falling into either of these subspaces. And the probabilities there were a half times 1 plus delta versus a half times 1 minus delta. And actually, in both the quantum and classical case, this was good enough to let us tell the difference between a very rigged or a very balanced die with quite good confidence. Okay, now I want to make the task a little bit trickier. I want to come up with a harder statistics problem. So here's going to be the new problem. Now your die, be it classical or quantum, is going to be in one of two cases, either perfectly balanced or slightly imbalanced. So perfectly balanced is going to correspond to the case where the probability distribution is uniform on the D faces. All the probabilities, the piece of J's are 1 over D, and therefore delta is the smallest thing it can be, which is, I guess, D times 1 over D squared, which is 1 over D. So that's perfectly balanced. And slightly imbalanced is going to refer to the case where it's not, you know, too close to perfectly balanced. This delta quantity is bigger than the minimum 1 over d by a factor of at least 2. Okay, so same game now. You know, you have a die, be it classical or quantum. You want to tell it, you promise that it's either perfectly balanced or slightly imbalanced. You want to tell which it is. And for now, I'm going to imagine that you still are only allowed exactly 2 copies of this die. Okay, well, let's think about the classical case first. You know, again, you're going to put into your sorted histogram measure, and you're going to see either this histogram or that histogram with these two probabilities. And think of these, just for now, as being, you know, heads or tails. Then, what's the probability you get heads? It's this delta. So you get heads with probability either exactly 1 over d in perfectly balanced case, or at least 2 over d in the slightly imbalanced case. So your task is now kind of like telling the difference between a coin, which is biased to come up heads, with probability either 1 over d or 2 over d. And, you know, if you know a little bit of statistics or probability, you know that in order to confidently distinguish these two biases, you need something like proportional to d measurements. You know, if you take, 50 times d of these pairs of measurements, these pairs of dice, and you get either, you probably get either, you know, 50 times this sorted histogram will come up, or at least 100 times it'll come up. And, you know, this is how you'll tell the difference. Okay. Now, what about the quantum case? Well, again, if you call the two outcomes, symmetric subspace and alternating subspace, heads and tails, now you see the probability of heads is either a half plus 1 over d or a half plus 1 over 2d. So you're trying to distinguish a biased coin where the bias, again, the biases in the two cases differ by something like 1 over d or 1 over 2d, but the bias difference is occurring around a half. And again, if you know a little bit of probability or statistics, you know that to reliably distinguish a coin whose bias is either a half plus 1 over d or a half plus 1 over 2d, you'll need something like d squared measurements. Okay, so that means that if, you know, what you've decided to do is to take, you know, your copies of the quantum die, break them up into groups of two, put them into the sim/alt measure, you know, in groups of two, then you'll need, you know, proportional to d squared groups of two in order to reliably tell the difference from between the perfectly balanced and the slightly imbalanced case. Okay, well, you can actually do better than this. Let's go back to the classical case in our minds for a moment. You see, imagine, you know, you're trying to distinguish slightly imbalanced from perfectly imbalanced in the classical case, and you're willing to, you know, make many measurements, or you're willing to use many copies of the die. Well, the smartest thing to do is not to, you know, group them together into pairs, and then do the sorted histogram measurement on each pair, and then try to collate the results of the sorted histograms you get. The smart thing to do is just put all those dice into one giant sorted histogram measurer and think about the result there. So, you know, here we have 16 dice. You put them into a sorted histogram measurer. In other words, you roll the dice and find out how many times did the most frequent face occur, how many times did the second most frequent face occur, how many times did the third most frequent face occur, and so forth. And then you stare at that and try to guess whether you're in the perfectly balanced case or the slightly imbalanced case. Again, with this particular example, it's a little hard to tell. I guess I would suppose that you're in the slightly imbalanced case if we got back this sorted histogram of 16 rolls. But in general, if you see a sorted histogram like this, the smartest way to look at it and guess whether you're in the perfectly balanced case or the slightly imbalanced case is not so obvious. However, it was worked out originally by this chap called Paninsky, and a little bit more in full detail by Chandiok and Nicholas Valiant. And it was shown that if you want to tell the difference between these two cases, perfectly balanced and slightly imbalanced, then actually proportional to square root d samples or rolls of the die are necessary and sufficient. Okay, this is a non-obvious result, but it also beats the proportional to d we saw in the method where you divide them up into pairs. Okay, well, what about the quantum version about this problem? Again, you know, suppose you're able to produce 16 copies of the quantum die. The best thing you can do, in principle, is not divide them up into pairs and put each pair into a sim-alt measurer. Instead, it's to, you know, build one giant measuring device that takes all 16 of these quantum dice in and measures them in some way. Now, things start to get a little bit mathematical here because you need a quantum measurement that, you know, is based on an orthogonal decomposition of the 16-fold tensor product of a vector space. And the optimal measurement involves some representation theory and some analysis based on shifted Schur polynomials. And I'll get into it a little bit later in these videos. But suffice it to say for now that with the optimal measuring device, as well as the optimal method of looking at the outcome of the measurement and guessing slightly imbalanced versus perfectly balanced, we were able to show with John Wright that proportional to d samples are necessary and sufficient. So again, this is better than the d squared we saw with the method that breaks these dice up into pairs. And it's, on the other hand, you know, quadratically more inefficient than the classical version of the problem. Okay. So as I said, you know, to understand the best way to do a measurement on many quantum dice requires a fair bit of representation theory. So we're going to get into it a bit slowly. Let's imagine sort of the next simplest case when you're allowed to get three copies of the die, be it quantum or classical. So again, let's start with the classical case. If you were trying to solve this problem, you'd roll those three dice, and the only information you'd need is this sorted histogram information. And just to remind you, you know, this sorted histogram information is... this corresponds to all three faces are the same, or in other words, the most common outcome occurred three times. This corresponds to one outcome occurred twice, and a different face occurred the third time. And this shape corresponds to all three rolls were distinct. Okay, and now it's some elementary probability to calculate the probabilities of these three events. So the probability of three rolls all being the same is the sum of the cubes of the PJs. Of getting this two copies of one outcome and one copy of a different one. That's three times sum of pi squared pj, and this is the sum overall distinct ijk of pi, pj, pk. Okay, so we have three different symmetric polynomials in the p's, and of course these are all possible outcomes, so these three polynomials happen to add up to one always. Okay, so again, we'd have to think, you know, if we saw the sorted histogram outcome, how to guess, you know, if it's very balanced, perfectly balanced or slightly imbalanced based on this, but this is at least how we'd start. Now, what kind of measurer would we use for three quantum dice? Well, again, you know, a measurement is an orthogonal decomposition into subspaces of, in the three dice case, CD, tensor CD, sensor CD. So we really want a natural decomposition of this tensor vector product space into subspaces that forgets two things. First of all, it should forget the n equals 3 ordering. So we don't really care about the order in which the dice appear. And it should also somehow try to forget about the d-dimensional orientations of space, because what we care about in this story, or this example, you know, perfectly balanced versus slightly imbalanced, really only depends on the p's. It doesn't depend on the orthonormal basis associated with the die. Remember, each die has, you know, you can think of it as like a die where the faces are labeled by the vectors in a orthonormal basis of CD. But this particular quantum statistics problem we have in mind for this example, slightly imbalanced versus perfectly balanced, only depends on the p's. Okay, so it turns out, and here we need some, you know, representation theory or linear algebra at least, that for the threefold tensor copy of a space, you still can decompose it into the symmetric subspace, which is all those tensors which are unchanged if you permute the tensor components in any of the six possible ways, together with the alternating subspace. This is, again, all the tensors that get negated. They pick up a sign if you transpose two tensor components. But unlike in the twofold case, that's not it. There's still more. There's like a third way in which threefold tensor products can be symmetric. For example, if you have like U and V as unit vectors and you look at U tensor U tensor V, well, on one hand, this is sort of 0% alternating. It has no projection to the alternating subspace because it has this repeated U. So if you transpose those two, you pick up a negation and that would cancel out. So, you know, this has no projection at all to the alternating subspace. But at the same time, this is not perfectly symmetric either. It changes if you permute the three tensor components. So this sort of is a little bit of a proof that there must be more in, you know, threefold tensor product space. And just to illustrate it, U tensor V can be written in this way. It's, you know, 1/3 times this long vector plus this other vector. You can check that via arithmetic. And you see this first vector is perfectly symmetric. So this first thing is in the symmetric subspace. But this second thing is not perfectly symmetric. And it's also not alternating at all because of these repeated U's. And indeed, this sort of piece of U tensor U tensor V is its projection into this third subspace. And, you know, it has a very fancy name, this third subspace, from representation theory. But let me just say this third subspace is called a symmetry type with this sort of histogram picture, or as they're actually called in representation theory, Young diagrams. So when you get into it, there is some natural reason for why the symmetric subspace is associated with this sorted histogram or Young diagram, this horizontal row, and also that the alternating one is associated with this vertical column of boxes, this sorted histogram. And there's a third, you know, sorted histogram, this one, and it's sort of associated with this last symmetry type of threefold vector tensors. So this will be the measuring device that we want, the measurement that we want. And again, I'll just say that, like, in principle, it's possible to build a measuring device, a physical measuring device that takes in three d-dimensional particles and reads out on its screen some lambda, and that lambda is either this sort of histogram or Young diagram, or this one, corresponding to symmetry types. Of course, you know, I mentioned last time it's, you know, quite challenging to make even two particles interact, so making three is even harder. And in, you know, physical reality, building a measuring device like this is basically at least as hard as building, you know, a full-fledged quantum computer that can operate on three, you know, quantum systems like this. So we probably won't be building this anytime soon, but what I'd like you to imagine is hypothetically, you know, once we have quantum computers, this would be the measuring device that we would like to use for this statistics problem. And once we have quantum computers, by the way, this particular measurement, decomposing it into this, these different symmetry types, is known to be, you know, efficiently computable in the quantum computing world. So that's good. Okay, so going back to this diagram, we know that with sort of the optimal measurement for three quantum dice for problems that depend on quantum problems that depend on the p's, again, the three possible readouts on the screen will be these three sorted histograms or Young diagrams, but they'll just have different probabilities. And I'm just going to tell you, you know, based on some little representation theory calculations, what the probabilities will be. So the probability of getting this sorted histogram or Young diagram is 1/6 the probability of seeing it in the classical case. So as you'll see, sort of the probabilities in the quantum case are all sort of shifted up. They're all like more towards these top heavy sorted histograms. Now this expression, the sum over distinct ijk of pi, pj, pk, also appears in the other two probabilities here. It appears with coefficient 2/3 here, and it appears with coefficient 1/6 here. And you'll notice this adds all up to sort of one copy of sum of pi, pj, pk. Again, this expression, this symmetric polynomial in the p's, also appears in the two expressions here. Two copies of it here and one copy of it here. And finally, this sum of the cubes of the pj's, this expression also appears here. Okay, so this screen is the final probabilities. It looks like kind of complicated. We'll see in a minute how it can be made less complicated. But it looks kind of complicated, but okay, you could work with it. So I'm telling you that if you do the sorted Young diagram-based, representation theory-based measuring device with three quantum states, you'll see this Young diagram with this probability, this Young diagram with this probability, this Young diagram with this probability, and these all add up to one, just because these ones all added up to one. Okay, well, it's getting a little complicated, and you might imagine, therefore, that it gets even more complicated if you have four quantum dice, or five quantum dice, or n quantum dice. The idea is kind of the same, though. If you have n quantum dice with probabilities p1 through pd, and you care about a quantum statistics problem that only involves the p's and doesn't involve the vectors, then without loss of generality, the correct way to forget the information that you don't care about, the orientation of space and the ordering of the n dice, is to use this symmetry type measurer, or to give it a more fanciful mathematical name, the Schur Weyl measurer. That term comes from some representation theory. So this measuring device can be built efficiently in principle, and it reads out a Young diagram or sorted histogram lambda, and this will have n boxes if you're feeding in n quantum dice, and it'll have d rows, or in fact up to d rows, and it'll look like a sorted histogram lambda with rows lambda 1, lambda 2, and so forth and so on. And for each sorted histogram or Young diagram like this lambda, there will be some probability that you'll see that lambda on your readout screen, and that will be dependent on P1 through PD. It'll actually be a symmetric polynomial in P1 through PD. And it has this formula, so depending on how much you love representation theory, you may or may not love this formula, but you can write it down. The probability of seeing this particular Young diagram lambda is this Schur polynomial in P1 through PD, indexed by lambda, times the dimension of the irreducible representation of the symmetric group on n letters indexed by lambda. So I'm just going to call this probability distribution on Young diagrams lambda the Schur Weyl distribution, notated SW n to indicate there's n boxes, and p because it really depends on p. And it's this probability distribution on Young diagrams lambda given by this formula. And, you know, this is what you kind of need to study for these quantum statistics problems. Okay, so let me tell you about what's going to come up in the next few videos. The first thing is, how can you try to infer aspects of P given a draw lambda from this distribution? So if you've got some quantum statistics problem about trying to figure out something to do with the P's of one quantum state, you know, the best thing you could do is put into this Schur Weyl measurer. You'll get a Young diagram lambda on your readout screen. And now you have to figure out, like, how do I take this lambda and, you know, infer something about P in the best possible way? Now, this is starting to look really complicated, especially because, you know, this is a rather complicated looking formula. But the key to, like, unlocking it and the way we'll be able to make a lot of progress on this, as I'll explain in the next video, is to come up with a completely different interpretation of this probability distribution. I'm going to describe for you in the next video a completely, you know, elementary dynamical process involving combinatorics and probability, no representation theory or anything, that will also give a random Young diagram, a random sorted histogram, and the induced probability distribution on sorted histograms will be exactly this Schur Weyl distribution with this formula. So it'll give us a completely different combinatorial way to understand this probability distribution, which is good because we have to, you know, figure out how you can infer things about the p's given one draw from this probability distribution. And finally, also coming up is the answer to the second question. Well, what if we also want to learn about the u's? Remember, these quantum dice, a quantum state has this probability distribution p1 through pd over a orthonormal basis u1 through ud. And the only quantum stats problems I've been talking about so far are things involving just the p's. But, you know, we might want to learn the entire quantum state, which involves learning both the p's and the u's. So that involves a little more representation theory, but we'll get to it towards the end of this video series.